He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the beggar from the ash heap to set them among princes and make them inherit the throne of glory. 1 Samuel 2:8a. We are a people called by God to positively impact and influence our generation. We are a living spring to a thirsty world, a place where imperfect people find true joy, genuine friendship, and practical truth for living from the Bible. In the preceding year, we run through a troop. We were confronted with challenges of a lifetime. Our resolve in God was tested. However, this year, we are leaping over walls. God is bringing His promises to pass. We are transitioning from divine acceleration to a season of divine upliftment. What the enemy meant for evil, God is turning around for good. There will be divine upliftment in our church, families, careers, financial status, jobs, and in every aspect of our lives. God is lifting us to a level we never envisioned. We will no longer operate in the valley. There will be divine upliftment, a place where eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of men. God is divinely lifting you to a place where you are a success, not a failure, a place where you are a victor, not a victim, a winner, not a loser, a place where you are not sinking, but soaring, a place where you are not defeated, but destined to rise higher. Because of the favor of God, protocols will be broken for your upliftment. You are ripened to enjoy divine recognition. You will rise above your equals. 2021, our season of divine upliftment. Get ready for the Word of God as we welcome our senior pastor, Reverend Kingsley Ayesu.
Let's go right into the Word. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 8. And then we'll read 1 Samuel chapter 1, and we'll go from verse 1 through 8. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 8. He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the beggar from the ash heap to set them among princes and make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth and the Lord's are the Lord's, and He has set the world upon them. You know, some will have all kinds of questions. You know, how can God do? Why will God do? And what? And all of that. But, and of course, we're going to go through it the entire year. But He says that He can do what He wants to do when He wants to do it, because the world belongs to Him. He set the pillars. So He can change it when He wants to. Hallelujah. My goodness. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 1. Now there was a certain man of Ramathaim Zophim of the mountains of Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Joraham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zoph, an Ephraimite. And he had two wives. The name of one was Hannah, the name of the other Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. Let's keep going. This man went out from his city yearly to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. Also the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, the priests of the Lord, were there. And whenever the time came for Elkanah to make an offering, he would give portions to Peninnah his wife and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he would give a double portion, for he loved Hannah, although the Lord had closed her womb. And her rival also provoked her severely to make her miserable, because the Lord had closed her womb. So it was year by year. You know, sometimes when we read this text, we think it was just a one service thing. But it was year after year after year. And I'm asking, Hannah, why do you keep going? Because at some point, you will go and I will wait. I will wait for you. Elkanah Penina, your children, you go and come. Food will be ready when you get home. Because we will understand as we go along that Hannah and Penina in the same house, and Penina does not provoke her until they get to church. What do you do when the place of peace becomes the place of your trouble? Because I have trouble at work, I have trouble at home. When I come to church, is that place where I come to worship and celebrate the King? If that place becomes a place of sorrow and pain and sadness, why do I keep coming? Year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, that she provoked her, and therefore she wept and did not eat. Verse 8. Then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? Look at your neighbor and say, purpose cannot be bought. Purpose is not the whole. You cannot pay her off. Father, help me this morning in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Please be seated. So we're going to start on a journey this year. Divine upliftment. Listen, I have struggled with this thing for months. I started working on this, my secondary term, started working on this for a while. And it got to a point where I wasn't very certain to stay with this theme for this year. I felt like there is the need for us to restart something. You know, it just didn't make sense to me to come to you this year and say, the Lord said it's going to be a year of divine upliftment. And so, she'll tell you, I actually had to change the text itself. Because I was thinking about it. I mean, people are down. People are broken. Jobs have been lost. There is sickness. There is pain. There is agony. And I'm thinking, God, I need a better word. And the Holy Spirit said to me, stay the course. Don't even think about it. When do you think you need divine upliftment? It is when men are down. Oh boy. It's going to be an amazing year. It's going to be an amazing year. You know, this is Vision Sunday, so we are just going to be talking. I'm just going to be all over the place. But don't worry, we'll land in a little bit. Because I'm supposed to give you an update. And we had our end of year meeting. And there wasn't much of update from most of the ministries. Because much didn't happen for them. Amen. But I realized that our young adults ministry fired up. And oh, I have good news for you, because you know, in the course of the year, we wanted to plant a couple of churches, all right? Wanted to plant a couple of churches, and when we tried, and we wanted to plant one in the northern part of Minneapolis, and you see, in the midst of the chaos, churches were shutting down. But I'm happy to announce to CCC that in a couple of months ago, we started London CCC. Oh, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. Listen, when churches were shutting down, we were starting branches. Are you hearing me, somebody? It is, I didn't say we are about to start. Oh, we have started. It is registered. It is set. Meetings are already taking place. Listen to me, somebody. The God who started with us last year and said we're going to have divine acceleration. Some of you are not paying attention. But if you look around you and you compare it to the previous year, you will realize that indeed we were accelerating. Ah, come on, somebody help me. Please sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down. Listen, listen. There is going to be, listen, the God that we serve is so amazing that when God begins to move, he moves as if the devil doesn't exist. Those of you who were on 31st night, you heard those who heard the testimonies. And listen, there are plenty of those testimonies you heard among us. It is in this year when people are talking about immigration is this, people are receiving their green cards here and there. Oh, I mean, I am standing here on this holy pulpit and I lie not to you. As a church, numerically we grew. When churches were going down, financially we grew. When churches were shutting up, we don't owe anybody, no credit card, nothing. Every bill has been paid. I think this is a good report for somebody to shout to the Lord that we serve. To make a noise, a crazy noise to the God of our... Listen to me, somebody. He did not bring us this far to disappoint us. Please sit down, sit down, sit down. And so I come to you humbly this morning with this conviction within me and this blessed assurance that this year will be a year of divine upliftment. Hallelujah. Are you still here with me? I said there'll be this the year of what? Come on, somebody talk to me. The year of what? I didn't hear you. The year of what? Hallelujah. Well, I didn't say, Minister Nick said we have to rise up to say it. So let us rise up on our feet. This is our year of what? Hey, it is our year of what? Come on, somebody help me out. You see, Minister Nick, when we're registering the church in London, when we started, they said it was going to take about, and the thing in London is so cumbersome. They said it's going to take about 6 months. So Pastor Isaac, when I told Pastor, I said, well, we have to wait because it's going to take about 6 months. In 2 weeks, it was approved. 2 weeks. Pastor David, 2 weeks. Now, if this is not acceleration, tell me, what is it? And the same God sent me to tell you this year that this is our year of what? Okay, okay, please sit down. Please sit down, please sit down. Please sit down, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, what is divine upliftment? Let me give you a working definition and then we will work the text. And trust me, I'm not going to get anywhere with the text. So we'll just see where the Lord... Divine upliftment is synonymous to the supernatural acts of God in one's life. The supernatural acts of God in one's life. This is when God raises you above all your enemies and your mockers. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. See, last year, we had divine acceleration. We picked up momentum. Do you realize we picked up momentum as a church? You know, some of you are so forgetful, You forget where we were 2 years ago. Things were so bad. And last year, when things were bad naturally, we were asking people to stay home. They said, Pastor, we want to come to church. And previous years, we were begging people to come to church and they won't come. And now we say, stay home. They say, we want to come. People will come to the door and they'll send them home and they are angry. We serve a mighty God. We serve an awesome God. You see, me, I don't forget who. I don't. I don't forget. I ignore things, but I don't forget. So I look around and I see the goodness of God. It is when God supernaturally acts in a person's life. It is when God promotes you to a higher level in life. It is when God sends you help when your efforts cannot produce the result that is required. And you see, I was putting, these are the things that I put together, I mean, a couple of months ago, and I was working on it. I keep, and I thank you, my secretary. I keep going by and saying, we have to change this. The Holy Spirit said this. And she keeps talking to our people, voice over, and all those things that it takes months to work on some of these things, just so you know. It's not a 1 week thing. You know, and Pastor David, as one person, I'm thinking, I said, God, you are talking about, you know, you are going to bring us to a place where our human efforts and said, see, divine upliftment is when you have tried, you have worked it out with your own effort, and then supernaturally, an invisible hand comes in and helps you and lifts you up. And that is where we are this year. And so you will go and you will sow in tears. You will come reaping in joy because a supernatural hand is about to help somebody. You didn't hear what I just said. Somebody's business is about to take over and it's about to rise up supernaturally.
Hey, maybe to those who are buying into it, maybe unto you, or God, maybe unto you, in the name of whatever moved you to come, may it be unto you. As the Lord has said, may you see it in the name of Jesus Christ. Are you hearing me? Divine lifting is God's promotion. It is when God promotes you, and when God promotes you, nobody can demote you. It is a positive change in a person's life. With divine lifting, listen, an ordinary man is made great and will sit with honorable people. Kaya, 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 kaya. Labrade, kereboko seketeye. Are you hearing me? Listen. Our high school students, we got people going to yell and think we got all excited. Listen, we are getting to a place that not one, not two, not three, we are going to have 10 children going to Ivy League schools out of. Okay. You mark my words. Some of you think, oh, he's just talking. You mark my words. Hallelujah. 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 We're talking about divine lifting brings people from the dust to the throne. I'm not making up. That's the word of God. When God decides to visit you, listen, the atmosphere changes and it becomes conducive for your upliftment. Divine upliftment is when God takes you from zero to a hero. Are you here with me? It is for you to go ahead of those who had earlier on gone before you. Listen, This year, you are going to overtake people in your way. I said, this year we are going to what? Overtake people. Divine upliftment, that is when you begin to have and enjoy divine recognition. Some of you, you will be recognized. At your workplace, you will be recognized. Listen, there are things you have been doing that nobody is paying attention. This year, they will pay attention. Your sacrifice, somebody will see it. Listen, your name will be mentioned in the corridors of power. I said your name will be mentioned in the corridors of power. Pastor Prince was sharing with me. He said, Pastor, I saw a ladder moving on earth to heaven. And he said, I saw our people climbing. They were 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 climbing. Are you hearing me? Careers are going. Listen, somebody's career is about to take off. Please sit down. Please sit down. Divine upliftment is when you rise up above your equals. It is when you are selected out of many for honor. Divine upliftment. Listen, I was telling, I believe it was Minister Nekai, I was telling him somewhere last year, you know, when Wells Fargo came up with all these rules and regulations about, you know, colored people and minorities and things. I said, you know what? Certain laws are going to be made in this land just to favor people in this church. Amen. See, some of you, you can't fathom it. A statement like that is just too much for you to believe. You just can't believe it. Laws will be made in this land, and it will favor this house. So our text, two women are married to one man. And by the way, it was okay in the culture that time. Just don't get any funny ideas. And a few things we know about this man. He was an Ephraimite, and we know he's wealthy. Because those days, the number of wives you have is an indicator of your wealth. Because it wasn't cheap. Even today, it's not cheap. Women are not cheap. Hey, they are not cheap. When I was young, my father used to tell me, he said in our local dialect, I have to translate it for you so you figure it out. He said, if you take women cheaply, you will get trouble cheaply. Because they are not cheap. So we know that Elkanah was doing very well. And you see, in those days, I'm building a case for you. We have to build a very solid foundation so you understand where we're going this year, all right? Because in those days, women were subservient. They were like second-class citizens. They were not even allowed to have careers, right? That is why you have to be thankful to Jesus for what he has done for you as a woman. Because, listen, it is not this women's rights movement that elevated women. Who, it was what he did on Calvary's cross. And he said, now there is no Jew or Gentile, there's no male or female, we are all one. And then when he wanted to report the best news to humanity, he used women. He was making a statement. And so in those days, the best a woman could do for yourself is to find a wealthy man to marry. And so Hannah had done very well for herself. She caught a good man, a wealthy man, and she married him. That was what Mama expected of her, and she did it. And she was the first wife. Why? How do I know she was the first wife? Because of the law of first mention. She's mentioned first. So she's the first wife. And then she gets into this marriage, and nothing happened. So the man has the right to pick another woman. And he brings Penina into the scene. And that is when things begin to unfold. Now, I'm going to mention a few things to you today, and then we'll start building on it as we go along. Is that okay? All right. The name Penina means precious jewel. Penina means precious jewel. Hannah means favored or grace. Hannah. Favored. Grace. Hannah had the favor. She had the grace. Both the favor of God and the favor of her husband. And yet, she was the one with the pain. I'm going to run through this real fast for you. Point number one. Purpose. Trust me. It will all not come together today. You will get it. See, Pastor Enoch, there are a lot of us sitting here under the sound of my voice. See, when you are 17 and 18 and you're trying to figure out, why am I here? It's okay. But when you are at 50 and you are still trying to figure out, what is my purpose? Why am I here? We are in trouble. Are you understand what I'm saying? When you are 17 and 18 and 20, I tell you have potential, you must be happy. When you hit 25, 30, we still say you have potential. Start getting nervous. When you are 35, 40, we still say you have potential. Start running. Something is dangerously wrong. Hallelujah. And so, but stay with me. I'll connect it in a bit for you, right? But purpose is the original intent for the creation of a thing. All right? So that is why everybody here under the sound of my, wherever you're watching us from, wherever, from London, from England, from Jamaica, from Turkey, wherever you're connecting, listen, no one is a non-entity. Listen, God did not create you and then try to figure out what he intended you to be. No. No manufacturer goes into production with that mindset. Before a manufacturer produces something, he already has exactly what he intends that thing to be, to do, and to be like. That is why, listen, don't allow anybody to put you down. Because of your color, because of your language, because of your looks, because of whatever. Because this is exactly what the manufacturer intended. He went into production and he did exactly what he wanted. Your weight is not a mistake. Hollywood has lied to us. Then a size 8 is the perfect size. It is total nonsense. Listen, there are some men who want a little bit of fat. Is that correct? Good to see you. Good to see you. Good to see you. I've seen you a long time. Hello, am I okay? Man, it's going to be an awesome year. Because listen, whatever you look like, God intended you to look that way. Thank you, my brother. Bible says we are wonderfully and fearfully made. So some will be wonderful, others will be fearful. Whatever you look like, you fulfill scripture. No, seriously. No, sometimes we get this thing. Listen, stop all this nonsense. There are people I know, even when they drink water, they put on weight. I'm being honest with you. But now you feel so bad about yourself. You are depressed. You are stressed. You are doing exercises that is not producing anything. Listen, exercise for good health. Yes, exercise so you have a good health and live long. Not because you want to be a size 8 for some man, because some man will. Listen, you keep on doing that. And the man is pushing you to be a size 8, and his pot belly is like he's 9 months pregnant, and everybody thinks that is okay. This is where the women say amen. Just be yourself. God did not make a mistake when he made you the way you are. You are for a purpose. You are for a reason. Jeremiah chapter 1 verse number 5. Please give it to me. Let me work something here this morning. Are you okay? Hollywood paints all this picture for us. Six packs. Listen. The one that has six packs can't put food on the table. He's always in the gym. Somebody has one pack, but is hard working. Holy Ghost filled, tongue speaking, anointed man of God. You better believe it. You better hang on with him because he's going somewhere. Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5. Before I formed you in the womb. Not when you got in the womb. Before. I determined your height, your color, where you were going to be born, your parents, your siblings. God said, I did not leave that to chance. Before I put you in your mother's womb, I predetermined that. You better feel beautiful because you are beautiful. He said, Before you were born, I sanctified you. Before you were born, I made you righteous. Listen to me. Just because you are struggling doesn't mean God can't use you. Oh, it's going to be a wonderful year. It's going to be a wonderful year. He said this, I ordained you a prophet. Before you were born, I sanctified you and I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Before. So before mama and daddy met, God already had you figured out. How dare you allow some man to tell you you are not worthy because of your weight or because of some degree you don't have. I'm not saying don't go to school. Go to school all you want, but not everybody has the brain for a PhD. Get it. There are people with PhDs who are begging for food. There are people who don't have a degree and they are millionaires. It is the blessings of the Lord that makes a man rich and adds no sorrow to it. If you have the brains to go to school, go to school, educate yourself, but do not let anybody put you down because you don't have a degree.
This is the air I believe. You're